Hello, everyone. I know this must be a little strange for all of you who are presenting to speak into the void, but we'll do the best we can. And thank you, Piers and team, for organizing this event. I'm going to quickly share my screen so I can start talking through some of the more interesting things that are happening within the space of augmented reality. Excellent. Great. All right. So we're here to talk about augmented reality in retail. Now, as probably a lot of you know, this is not a new topic or a new technology. It has certainly been on a lot of people's radar, especially within the retail space, I'd say for the last 4 or 5 years, with a lot more deployments coming in the last 1 or 2 years. But the reason I want to talk about it today specifically is how can augmented reality help retailers cope with the unprecedented set of issues that they're currently facing? So what are those issues? So I think it's probably an understatement to say that it's a perfect storm. There have never been, at least in my experience, this many different pressures on retailers to perform well, to perform under stress and strain from all angles, right? So we're talking about things that are fundamental to the retail business. From the very basics, like store closures, right? They're drastically reducing the sales for retailers. And as a double whammy, they've also eliminated a lot of the workers or have them furloughed that retailers have to depend on in an already kind of volatile labor workforce. Second, if you do have your store open, you have the usual the constraints that we've all come to live with around physical distancing and masks. And now you also have capacity limitations in terms of physical spaces that are all creating burdens and constraints to store traffic. Third, you have supply chain issues up and down the chain that are reducing the number of items on shelf, the variations, the number of items, number of SKUs, the total number of shelf level items, so that your stores actually don't look like they are meant to look. That they're designed experiences where retailers are providing the best that they can to their customers. You have infections, a threat to the labor workforce, right? So even if you do have people coming in, that could cause a cascade of infections that would result in a further handicapping the store level workforce. So you have, it's not enough that you're okay now. You might be, further strained later on if you don't take care of the pandemic and how to deal with containment. And of course, there's the local state, the county, the state, the national guidelines and regulations on how to deal with this crisis, which are constantly changing. And so that's another stress and strain as well. So these are significant in and of themselves, but all combined together makes it quite overwhelming to figure out how to deal with it. What I want to talk about today is how these changes may actually hint at longer term behavioral changes in how people shop. So yes, there are unprecedented changes that are happening right now. It doesn't look like we're going to get back to normal anytime soon. And by soon, I mean this year, possibly even next year. But more interesting is, does this result in a fundamental shift in shopper behavior over time? And it's too early to say, but some of the signs are starting to indicate that perhaps the way that consumers have been used to shopping may not necessarily be the way they shop going forward. So what do I mean by that? Well, as a snapshot in real time, just from a couple of months ago, you see that the number of in-store shopping purchases versus the number of e-commerce and digital purchases have drastically increased, largely out of necessity, right? And you could have almost flipped that graph if you were to think about sort of pre-COVID times. Maybe not exactly, but there was a lot more in-store shopping happening. But now you're looking at single digits in some cases for shopping these items. And when you talk to these customers about what they intend to do going forward, you're starting to see that, visiting stores or shopping for stores, they're interested in going back into the stores. I think there's a pent-up demand to have social interactions, so that'll always drive store visits. But what you might find is that for the items that don't require a store visit, or perhaps they could have a better experience through a digital mechanism or tool, that shoppers will be probably likely to switch to digital, right? I'm thinking about hard goods, furniture shopping. There are certain some examples where that might be the case. But it is certainly something to watch. It is something to understand that this Corona and COVID-19 have created short-term sustained stressors on retail and the consumers. And this might result in long-term shopping changes over time. So why are we talking about AR given all of this immediate threat, right? So with fewer shoppers at the store, I believe there's an opportunity to accelerate direct to consumer with AR. And the good news is a lot of this has already been, was either under development or being considered as a pilot. So the technology isn't radically new. We're not talking about massive billion-dollar ERP investments or supply chain logistics. We're not talking about deploying tablets in the thousands to the, through the thousands of stores. We are talking about something that is a much more accessible way to deal with the short-term issues of the coronavirus. So what are some ways in which, I'll go through this in more detail, but here are some of the high-level ways in which I've seen, we've seen AR help retailers reach their customers. First, it's around product selection. When you no longer can touch and feel the products at the store, you need the next best thing, and that might very well be an AR view of that same product. Being able to see it at home, of course, starting in 2017 with the IKEA app, but that hasn't stopped. There have been multiple retailers that have deployed additional, see at home, fit it, does it fit kind of capabilities inside of your mobile phone. Wayfair comes to mind, where you're able to get a much better glimpse of the product and how it looks at home. And I want, and I'll go into a little bit more detail of why that's not just a substitute, but it's actually a better experience in some cases than what you had before. Another use case that we've seen quite a bit is around product fit. So I want to know if this thing, how it looks on me. Will it fit me? And those are the kinds of examples we're starting to see from some of the soft goods retailers, some of the shoe apparel retailers. So those are interesting to track and keep an eye on, and I'll talk about them in a little bit more detail. Customer service, or any services in general that require home visits, have been curtailed. And so how do you reach and go into homes where you've previously had service offerings, whether it's a Geek Squad-like offering or if it's a repair offering? How do you go into their homes and help them out? And so we'll talk about that. And then finally, there's just the safety that comes out of applying AR to the operations of retail. And by that, I mean things like what ASOS has done with their virtual photo shoots, what folks are looking at with virtual end caps, signage, promotions. So there's a lot of things that you can, there's a lot of ways in which you can use AR as an operational tool to help drive safer, deployment of labor force, more efficient deployment of labor force, and even perhaps provide a better experience for customers at the same time. So we've talked about AR. Let me just spend a little bit of time explaining AR, because I often find that there is some confusion. So what is AR? So augmented reality, I define augmented reality as the ability to project information onto the real world through the perspective of the viewer, enabling them to experience digital objects in the physical world. And that sounds like magic, but that's essentially what AR feels like when it's done well, right? AR relies on a set of cameras to understand what the user sees and then to place information and 3D objects onto the scene, matching the user's perspective. And when it's done well, AR brings these objects to life, and it's quite remarkable, some of the examples we've seen. So I've defined sort of what AR is, but how is it different from VR, MR, XR? So I'm going to talk about the difference between augmented reality and virtual reality. MR and XR, you can think of them as combinations of the fundamentals of augmented and virtual. So what are the fundamentals of augmented? It is through a live camera view, right? Augmenting your view. It can be deployed on smartphones or dedicated headsets, of which there are not too many now. So mostly it's smartphone deployments. It's untethered, meaning you are not tied down to a PC. You are using your smartphone and it goes wherever you go. It can take advantage of your location because it is deployed through a smartphone, has access to GPS. There are location-based experiences that can be triggered that consumers and shoppers can experience that would otherwise not be possible. And it does not require a controller. You already have the device in your hand, right? So that's augmented reality. Virtual reality is a complete replacement of your worldview. It is seen through the eyes of a headset, whether it's a dedicated headset or a headset where you pop your phone in, it doesn't really matter, but you're definitely closing out the view of the world outside and replacing it with something virtual on the inside. It is typically tethered to a PC because it happens to be very computationally intensive. So it's, you know, to display graphics and to be able to track your position in 6 degrees of freedom and to be able to display that information in a very low lag latency takes a lot of computing power. And that's just not something that right now can be deployed on the smartphone. It does not take advantage of your location because you are tied to a specific PC. It requires a dedicated controller, though now there's advancements in how they're recognizing your hands as a means of interaction. And it's visually immersive. You know, when virtual reality is done well, it is actually quite remarkable how much it transports a user into a different world. Now, there are potential applications for virtual reality in retail. Today, I'm going to be covering AR, but if you have questions about virtual reality in retail, please email me and I'll provide my contact information later on and we can go from there. So as I go down the presentation, I'm going to probably stop at some points when I get questions and try to answer them as I get them in real time. So one of the questions was around what opportunities do you see for FMCG brands using AR in a retail environment? That's a good question. Right now, a lot of the examples are around, you know, hard goods, apparel, furniture, jewelry. And so we don't see a lot of food-based deployments of AR, which does not mean, however, the use cases have not been found. I can easily see food, quick serve restaurants using AR as a way to help consumers understand what they're ordering, or as a way to preview menus outside before they go in, as a way to understand, you know, for example, there's a lot of takeout orders. Maybe there's a different ways of experiencing kind of what you're going to be getting beforehand. So it doesn't jump, you know, FMCG doesn't jump out right away as a natural starting point for AR, but there are likely examples worth diving into and going into more detail. The next question was, who are the key AR development partners and agencies that large brands are partnering with? Now, it ranges. Now, typically what we've seen is AR being the way that large companies are often going about it is leaning on their digital partner of record. That might be the Accentures and the Deloittes of the world who are already running a lot of the IT systems. And so they're typically tend to approach it as an extension of their IT infrastructure. And so that's one major way in which store-wide and retail-wide deployments are happening. Another angle that is happening is around individual regional store-level pilots with small startups. So for example, the IKEA app that we're all probably very familiar with was not actually a headquarters-based deployment of IKEA's you know, kind of now famous, how does it look in my room kind of, it was actually done by one region working with a startup and deployed to help enhance that shopping experience for that region. So that wasn't a store level retail, you know, store-wide, you know, deployment. So you have these small one-offs that are pilots and experiments to see does it work well. And then you have these large scale enterprise level deployments that do require quite a bit of work in terms of capturing 2D products and moving them into, you know, you need a pipeline to move 2D into 3D before you can actually have an AR experience. You need to create that pipeline within the current workflows of your content management systems. You need to be able to tie them into item level and SKU level pricing information so that you're not displaying something on AR that is out of date already. So there is work to be done at enterprise level scale, but a lot of these retailers, even however big they are starting small, starting regionally, starting store level, to be able to experiment and fine tune the use cases to the ones that work for their shoppers. And the last question I'll take before I move on is around some consumer goods. They've been softening demand due to social distancing. Apparel comes to mind. How do you think retailers might address those changes? Can AR enhance demand? So I'm going to address that actually as I go through the use cases. So I'll probably be answering that question for you. So if I don't at the end of the end of the presentation, feel free to email me as well. Okay. So these are just the AR launches that have happened in the last 6 months. Now, this is quite an interesting collection of retailers. And maybe you can spot the pattern, but essentially I've arranged them in columns in terms of fashion, beauty, automotive, soft apparel, furniture, home goods and home improvement, and finally toys. So I'm not going to go through every one of these in detail because there are quite a bit, and I'm sure there are more. But I wanted to really highlight the fact that in the last 6 months, you've seen a lot of deployments of AR. Now, I don't want to say that they're in response to COVID because these have been in development prior to that in 2019. However, in certain cases, the AR deployments have been accelerated because of COVID. So instead of deploying it in the second half of 2020, some of these retailers have actually moved up their AR deployments to be able to see how well they will work in addressing some of these challenges that we talked about earlier. All right. So let's go through some of these categories. I'm trying to pick ones that are interesting from each of these categories. And what I will do is I will try to avoid showing you ones that you might have already seen. And if the screen changes around a little bit, apologies for that. Still getting used to this way of presenting. Okay, so fashion retail. So, and by the way, there are probably a lot of the well-known brands that I'm going to avoid talking about because they are so well-known. So I've tried to pick the ones that are perhaps brand new and relatively recent or a little less known so that we can look at some examples that are more interesting and perhaps more niche. So fashion retail. So we're talking about Kendra Scott embracing digital in a big way. And use case wise, it isn't particularly novel or new, but it is interesting in the sense that AR is now becoming part of a chain-wide or a brand-wide engagement strategy rather than as a one-off platform, one-off experiment, right? So you can, I think the biggest, element of this deployment specifically is around things like dynamic lighting. So when you're buying fashion, you really need to make sure that what you're looking at is as good as the real thing or as close to as the real thing as possible. And one of the elements that help you do that is dynamic lighting, the ability for lighting to change on the object you're presenting that is digital based on your real world lighting conditions. That's very complicated because you need to understand where light's coming from. And it isn't perfect today, but a way to sort of get past that limitation is to mimic lights and to show that light changing. And so even though in this app, you will see that it does look a little bit like you can tell that it's still digital. Those kinds of technologies are getting much, much better at being able to showcase the object in as close to a realistic perspective as possible, which is particularly important in fashion more than, let's say, other categories. Suit Supply has actually started building out their retail. They're doing more than just AR, of course, but it is interesting that as part of their overall redesign of the stores, as a response to COVID, they're also doing things like virtual shopping experiences with experts that allow you to get help from experts that they have on staff using AR and your smartphones. Okay. You're probably familiar with this example, but if you're not, it's basically ASUS using AR as a way to simulate apparel on models without having to do photo shoots that require a lot of folks to gather together in one single place. So the ability to take the same things that you might deploy from a consumer point of view, but also then to do it from a operational point of view is a really interesting shift and it's just a development in AR, where we've been talking a lot about consumer use cases, but now you can start to see it going into the back of the store and starting to affect how operations are done, which are just as much constrained and impacted by the COVID-19 situation as well. In beauty, another great example, we've seen this before in terms of the ability to apply filters. It is becoming much more tied into the product line and the brand so that you aren't just doing it for fun, but you're now actually able to shop through these filters. So the interesting part that stood out for me about this was that COVID-19, again, has constrained the ability for users to go into the store. So you need to go to where they are, and they're on social media. And L'Oreal's example is a great one where they've been able to insert their brands into social media platforms in a way that feels natural, is very relevant, and ties back to their overall brand experience and ties into their, allows consumers to purchase from there. So there's sort of a end-to-end value chain for consumers to be able to shop L'Oreal without having to go to a L'Oreal store, a L'Oreal website, or download a L'Oreal app. And so I think one of the key takeaways, at least from this example, is that the store has been a place where retailers have often created the perfect context for shopping. You've been able to design that store to ideally enhance that shopping experience with customer service reps, with the music, with the architecture, with the layout, the configuration. That is a defined, well-defined space. Well, consumers no longer can go into that space that you have so carefully curated and designed. So you need to go to where consumers are. And that may no longer mean your app, your website, and your store. It might have to be in other places. So how do you maintain this brand touch point? How do you maintain the feel of the brand in all of these locations while still giving people access to the products that you carry? I think that's the real kind of opportunity here, is to think about how you take products out of the store, or at least a store experience, and distribute it digitally into locations where people are naturally going to be. This next one, I love personally because I'm really into cars. We're starting to see augmented reality in cars, car shopping becoming much closer together. Lamborghini, in this case, is used AR as part of their launch campaign to help consumers purchase their Huracan. I think it's the Huracan Evo. Huracan Evo. So if you're in the market for a Lamborghini, I would suggest you try this out. Even if you're not in the market for a Lamborghini, probably like most of us, please try it out. But it's been a really interesting way to see automotive embrace AR as a natural way to extend their dealer network and their dealer experience, which has obviously been hit just as much as any of the other traditional retail has. So Ignacio, actually, would if you have the video that we talked about, it would be good to kind of just play that very quickly, right? Okay, great. So we'll go quickly. So a number of other use cases that we've captured. So let me skip to the main part. When is AR worth using? It's worth using when consumers want to answer product questions, when you want product views, there's complicated products you need to explain, you need to tell brand stories, but it's not good at everything, right? You don't want to throw technology for technology's sake. It's not great at things like finding the lowest price or comparing items together. It's not good for, you don't want it for purchasing basics and commodities, even though they might be examples of that. and definitely not good for personalization yet, because there isn't that ability in the platform side to personalize AR to your experiences. So just as I rush through, kind of towards the tail end to make sure that you guys got a chance to think about the reflection question. So are you looking at this COVID-19 situation as a way to return to status quo, or are you looking at it as an opportunity for innovation? And I hope you are doing the latter. Are you ready to kind of identify use cases that might work and start investing in building those capabilities? Or have you already been doing that and now are ready to accelerate them? It probably is worth considering. Are you looking at AR as just an extension of digital commerce or as a way to augment physical commerce? Both are relevant. And in fact, I would suggest looking at it through the lens of a user journey rather than through, you know, an omni-channel view. And are you approaching AR through the lens of user-centered and business perspective? So yes, there's a technology that we can do. Yes, there's a consumer need, but does it satisfy a business? And so the ability to look at all three things in together is what we do at Hypermatter. So after leaving Samsung, started a consultancy called Hypermatter, where I take my 15 plus years of experience in retail and experience at Samsung developing new technologies. And we look at technologies like AR for industries like retail and help you understand what are some of the opportunities and use cases that can help bring your business back, right? And lastly, I'm going to leave with this. The future is unpredictable. You know, 3 years ago, the prediction around retail 2020 was that it's going to be robots and augment, you know, beacons and all that stuff. And now I love the comment, the first one that says, update, it's 2020, and now we're fighting over toilet paper. So the future is unpredictable. We don't know what's going to happen next. So you don't fight it. You have to, as Buckminster Fuller said, you never change things by fighting reality. You have to change something by building a new model. So I hope we get a chance to build this new reality together. And it's been a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you.